want, just lift your hands and just cry out, holy with us. Come on, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. There is none like you, oh God, none beside you. Come on, we declare that you're holy, Jesus.
Good morning from the heart. Live streamers, family, friends, visitors. Welcome to this beautiful, beautiful in Waldorf Sunday morning service. We're experiencing the most beautiful morning, and it's going to get even more beautiful. Please stand and join us for our praise and worship service.
Give him glory,
give him glory.
Good morning from the heart.
Good morning.
Good, glorious morning from the heart. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it as we have our morning worship service. Amen. Amen. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth in his hand. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is pure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord, amen, let me slow down. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Morgan will now come to pray this morning's invocation.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O Lord, our God, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Father, you are Alpha and you are Omega, the beginning and the end. And we exalt you on high this morning because you are God, the one true and living God. And Lord, we thank you for your grace and your mercy this morning. We thank you for Jesus Christ, who is Lord, who is King, who is Master, who is our friend. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for all that you have done for all the world. And now you sit at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty, interceding on our behalf. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for your love. And God, we would be remiss if we didn't thank you for your blessed Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, you are welcome into this service on this morning. Take charge over every aspect. Go up and down the pews, up and down the hearts of your people this morning. May we be aligned with the truth, the goodness and righteousness of who you are, God. We are so thankful to be in the house this morning, and we desire to worship you just because of who you are. So have your will and your way throughout the service. It's in Jesus' precious and holy name we give thanks. Amen.
Over me.
washed away all my sins, and he made me whole.
He
sit at his feet to do what must be done. I'll work and work until he comes. A wonderful change, wonderful over me. Sit at his feet to do what must be done. I'll work and work until he comes. A wonderful change, wonderful.
You can remain seated as we prepare to pray, but I want to shout out our hymn choir. What's interesting is all three of the people who just ministered are in different ministries. Literally, Courtney had to put on her robe as she was moving from behind the camera, who's serving in that capacity, to be able to be up here. Both she and Brother O'Neill serve in the media ministry, and Dr. Lagan serves also in the altar ministry and is also a part of the Call on Lives ministry. And that goes back to what the great work that we did yesterday with the All Ministry Day. You know, you can be in more than one ministry.
That's right.
And, you know, yes, you should be in one, but you can be in more than one. There's a work for us to do, and it requires us to put our hands to the plow to do a great work. Amen?
Amen.
Church, we've been wearing these masks for 3 years now, right? I know. Y'all been like, yes, we have. And I told the Board of Trustees, and we were talking with the Board of Trustees some time ago, I said, you know, after Easter, I want the folks to breathe a little bit during service.
Thank you, sir.
So,
Thank you.
For those who are comfortable, masks going forward will be optional. Now, the official date was going to be on May 7th. No, you can still keep yours off, but as you're in service today, if you feel led to, you know, take it off and get a little extra breathing room, you can. Don't judge the folks who keep their mask on.
Amen.
And folks, don't judge the folks who take their mask off. Amen? Don't judge, period. I'm going to keep mine on and off throughout the service. Amen?
Amen.
But I wanted to announce that it had been in my heart for a long time, and May the 7th is coming up real quick. And I saw us fanning in here today. I said, you know what? Today might be the day, Lord.
Amen.
So I stuck with the idea of it being after Easter. But certainly, you know, use your guidance. If you're not feeling well, stay home. Somebody say, please. But no, we want folks to, we're trying to get back to a place where we can worship God without any hindrances.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
And all the hindrances we have left are the excuses for which we don't serve the Lord. On another note, I want to thank each and every one of you for praying for my family and I. My Uncle Sonny did pass yesterday, and I had a chance to go down and be with him on, I don't know what day, Thursday. Thursday, yes. We went down Thursday, and it was a blessing to be with him. He was pretty much incoherent, but there were times he could open his eyes, he could look my way. And he recognized my voice, and he tried to speak, but he could not speak. But he did pass yesterday, and one of our other cousins is now going to make his way from Arizona to Kinston, North Carolina. Big town, big K-town, and as big as this pulpit. But God bless the folks in Kinston. They think they're doing something down there. But so we were supposed to go down tomorrow, and when our cousin called and said, hey, you know what the doctors are saying? For those who can, get here. You know, that call you get, we got that call. So I said, you know what? And just so you know, he is my only uncle, and I'm his only nephew. So we have a phenomenal relationship over the years. He was 87 years old and stubborn as a mule. No one ever called him ugly, so he thought he was the finest brother walking. So we get a chance to laugh and just enjoy his legacy, amen? Also, as we're celebrating his life, I got to shout out my son and his beautiful bride-to-be, Jayani. So let me fast forward. We are doing a destination wedding in 2 weeks on the 30th, going to Cancun for them to be married. But when you have a destination wedding, they want you to get married in your state, because in case it don't work out too well over there, at least you know you got a license here. So they're actually getting married this Thursday. So we're doing the spiritual union this Thursday morning, then we're going down to the courthouse Thursday afternoon, and then we're going to fly to Cancun for them to be married three times.
Yeah.
I said, boy, you better be married for 100 years. You're getting married three times. I'm going to be officiating the wedding in Cancun. It's an honor. He had me to be his best man and also to be the officiant, and so what a wonderful blessing that will be. So we're excited about that. So we got three weddings and a funeral to do. That was a movie, Four Weddings and a Funeral. So we got a lot going on in my life right now, so be patient with your pastor. But thank you. When I say pastor, they know it means first lady. Everyone lift a hand and get that petty spirit off of her. I'm going to get it later, so it's fine. She can't beat me, I don't think. She can fight now. Anyway, enough about her and me. Hey, this is what happens in our life all the time. If you want to see what married life is between a pastor and first lady, here it is right here. This is how we act all the time. Anyway, back to being serious, I think. I don't know. It's over. Anyway, be in prayer with our family. We thank you all for that. I'm now going to invite Minister Gloria Milhouse to come forth to pray this morning's prayer. Amen.
Amen.
Stay seated.
Thank you, Lord. Let us pray. Good morning, Father. We love you. We exalt your name on this day. We exalt you because you gave us sleep last night and woke us up this morning to seek a brand new day. We thank you, Lord, for watching over us, helping direct us and guide us. We pray for From the Heart Worldwide, Bishop and his wife, and keep them safe as they travel. We pray and thankful for our pastor and Sister White, for of this local church, for their hearts. Lord, be with their family during this time of need, who those who would be traveling far and near. This day we want to pray for those who are going through in this critical time, in areas of healing, medical procedures and tests, deliverance, thanksgiving, and bereavement. Lord, we ask you to continue to help us to press toward the goal of the prize of the upward calling of God in Jesus Christ. Family, I say, brethren and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. Continue to follow his way. He is the truth and the life. Walk in his obedience and be strong in the Lord, and he will take care of you. He sees everything from time we were born till now. Lord, we give you all the honor, the praise for who you are, to go to give us the glory and the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Well, church, I've come to the part of the service that I enjoy, and that is welcoming our first-time visitors. If this is your very first time to the sanctuary, please stand all over the sanctuary. I see you. Please stand so you can't hide. You can't hide. I would also welcome our live streamers. Hello. We pray that the service will be all that you need it to be, and I'm absolutely sure it will be, and we thank you that you came today. Amen. You may be seated. We do have something special for you, and most of the congregation knows what it is. And so on three, we're going to give them that special thing that we have for them. Ready? One, two, three. Welcome. I do want to remind everyone, as always, we have a Bible study on Wednesdays at 7:30, so please come out and or tune in. Amen?
Amen.
I have some announcements, just a few. We want to celebrate and acknowledge the 10-year wedding anniversary for Brother and Sister Adrian and April Brown. 10 years ago. Watching at home, happy, he's outside. Okay, happy anniversary. I did see him this morning. I didn't see April this morning. That's what it was. Happy anniversary. We have some numbers in from the commissioner. So y'all know we are competitive here at From the Heart of Waldorf. So
one of these numbers we have to verify.
Uh-oh. Yeah. Yes.
I mean,
where's the commissioner? I saw her. Okay, there she goes. I was like,
tell the folks who don't know what we're doing.
So we have a step contest, or what, do we call it a contest? Challenge. I call it a contest because that's what it is. So for a week we have teams, and everybody gets their steps in. You have your stepper counter on it. And on Sundays we turn in our numbers, and we have several teams. And whoever gets the highest step, we acknowledge them. You don't get a prize, you just get acknowledged. Amen? So we have the top steppers, and I'm only giving the top three, and they are, we're going to start with the third person, and that is Sister Powell with 115,578 steps.
Yeah.
Then we have Brother Brian Drummond, not related to Henderson. He has 129,927 steps.
Now this is the one we have to
This is the one we need to go to, that the step watch was on the dog running in the backyard or something. Brother Demir, are you here today? No. Okay. He had 213,000 steps.
213,000.
So those are the top three. So the team that won, which he is on, is Team A, which is Sharon Mitchell. We're gonna have her as the captain. Teresa Henderson, Diamond, John T, myself, amen. Cynthia and Demir. So Team A won. Team D was not too close, but
30,000 points. Your pass was on that.
Oh, you already counted that up.
Yeah,
okay,
that up.
All right. So Team D was second. Amen. So it.
Excuse me.
Team Roberts. Let's see. Let me make sure I have my numbers right here. 468,000, so we were 30,000 steps off. They had one person with 213, Sister Daniels, we love you, but, you know, I got to check Demir later. We're going to check him. I'm just saying, 213,000 steps. When I saw that last night, I'm thinking, okay, maybe, you know, Maria, you know, she can't see no more because she's getting older.
She did just have a birthday. Right?
She just had a birthday, and we know how old she is. So I said, well, maybe she can't see. Maybe she had the numbers twisted around or something.
I was like, oh, something's wrong.
Maybe it's 132.
Yeah.
Not 213. So anyway, Sister Roberts, because I'm on your team, we were $30,000 short, 30,000 points short.
$30,000.
Yeah, it felt like that. We lost some money. So we'll check those numbers later, all right? As you were, please.
Thank you. As it relates to the step challenge, I want to make sure everyone knows when the commissioner sends the email out to send your numbers in, please reply within that email. It makes it easier to capture all the numbers versus putting it on Realm or texting it to her. Amen?
Amen.
So at this time, we're going to have our offertory prayer by Brother Minister Jephthah Milhouse. Brother Minister.
Brother Minister.
Brother Minister. Let us pray. Father, we thank you, we praise you, we glorify you. We come to you in the matchless name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the name that you have given us to have access to you. Jesus, we thank you for the opportunity to give. Thank you for allowing us the opportunity to participate in the ministry of giving and receiving. God, you showed us how to give by giving your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. But you didn't stop there. You also gave us our Holy Spirit. So, Father, we thank you and we praise you for showing us how to give. Now, Father, as we give, we pray that leadership will use wise stewardship over all the gifts. And, Father, those that are unable to give, may you allow them to give maybe next time. God, we thank you and we praise you. We give you all the glory. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As far as scriptures are concerned, we're going to be in two places of the Bible, Ephesians chapter number 5, and also we're going to be over in Philippians chapter 3, Ephesians 5 and Philippians chapter number 3. Amen. See you soon. Good.
Rescue the souls of men. Oh, you rescue the souls of men.
I have a correction to make. Our son and this beautiful bride-to-be get married this Friday, not this Thursday, it's this Friday. We have another funeral to assist with on Thursday. So we have 3 weddings and 2 funerals. Whew. Just remember that. So sorry for that. So Friday. Because our altar ministry and special services team were like, Pastor, it's Friday. It's not Thursday. Like, thank you. Correct your pastor. I'm here for that. Today's message will be a reset. We need to reset. 90% of it will be review. And this message today is a single message. It will lay the foundation for all the messages to come for the remaining part of the year. Only take notes based upon the leading of the Father. Don't worry about keeping up with me today, because all of it you should have. For most of us, we should have all these notes. Because again, I'm only going to review what's been taught throughout this past 15 or so weeks of the beginning of the year. Amen? So let's pray and hear from the Lord. Father, we love you, and we praise you, and we thank you that we have the chance to hear from you right now. So I'm going to decrease, and Father, you're going to rise bold in me by your Spirit to teach and to preach what's on your heart and what's on your mind. And I pray that we will block out all distractions. We'll focus in on hearing from you, Father, and not just hearing from you, that we'll hear with a mind to obey, to receive, and to do that which you've called us to do. And that, Father, we will share your word with others so they can taste and see how good you are. We love you, Father. We praise you. It's in Jesus Christ's name we do pray and give thanks. Amen. With our Bibles turned to Ephesians chapter 5, I'm going to do a review in reverse and then move forward. Amen. From January 15th through last week and Resurrection Sunday, our messages on Sunday have been influenced by the teaching series entitled Move with Fear. Church, whether you know it or not, we've spent roughly 15 weeks under that theme, if you will, of Move with Fear. And I promise you now, I cannot do a thorough review of Move with Fear. You got to go back and watch that for yourself on YouTube. I said, church, to move with fear, we must remove the excuses. Again, we make time for the things that we want to do, and we make excuses for the things that we don't want to do. What we have to do, church, is remove the excuses. Once we remove the excuses, church, we can walk with God. Once we're able to walk with God, then we can follow his specific instructions that he's given us. And once we've done all of that, guess what we can do? We can finish. And once we finish, we can enjoy the benefits of moving with fear. And we saw that over in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7. We saw the benefits that Noah was able to receive for heeding the warnings of God. He was able to save his family. He was able to condemn the world. And church, he became an heir of righteousness. And we learned that, guess what? We're heirs of righteousness as well. And then, going backwards, on the 8th of January, a week before we actually started that whole series on Move with Fear, I did a single message entitled, Stop Wasting Time. And I listened back to that. I said, oh my God, that was rough. I apologize. That was a lot. I was dodging the blows and the swings. But church, we have to stop wasting time. And listen to what I said back on the 8th of January. I said, church, we have all wasted enough time. There is no more time to waste. I said that God's encouraging us to be a wise steward over his time. Time is his. He's given it to us. It's the most precious gift outside of Jesus Christ that he's given to us. How about this? God gave us time before he gave us Jesus. God gave us time before he gave us breath in our body. Time was here at the very beginning. One of the first things God spoke into the earth was time. I said, church, we must stop wasting the time that God has given us.
I said the most despicable, disrespectful, and disgraceful act that we can commit is to waste God's time. I said wasting time is a crime. It's a crime against God. I said, church, not only must we stop wasting the time that God's given us, we must stop wasting the time that God has given others as well. And here's why I said we have to stop being time jackers. We have to stop being time jackers. And I said, in order to stop wasting time, we must eliminate the time robbers. And those time robbers are the unproductive thoughts that we have in our mind. They're not external, they're internal. We're the ones robbing us of our time and other people's time. And I said there were three unproductive thoughts that we have to eliminate. Dwelling on the past, dwelling on things that we cannot control, and dwelling on what other people have. Church, I've said this before, we hold on to the past. It does not hold on to us. The past does not have arms. We hold on to it. And we have to stop dwelling on things that we can't control. You know, there was a time in my life I wanted to be light-skinned with green eyes and curly hair. Well, guess what? As you can see, and I prayed for that when I was young, and it didn't happen. I actually lost the good hair that I had. I had a good grain of hair. And God said, for you praying that ridiculous prayer, boom, no hair. You know, it is what it is. And church, we have to stop dwelling on what other people have. Comparison breeds discontentment. It's okay if somebody else worked really hard to get what they have. How about this? Even if they didn't work really hard to get it, it's still theirs. Even if they stole for it, it's still theirs. Don't be jealous about what other people have. I ended that message by saying, church, we're on the clock. And the clock is ticking. But I said, I gave us some good news. I said, if we're still here, God has given us more time. But what we can't do is waste the remaining time that God has given us. Now, that was from this past Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, up until January 8th, right? Let me take you back to the first day of the year, which happened to be a Sunday, where our Episcopal pastor delivered an address, an Episcopal address. He said this, church, this is a critical time. This is a critical season of time. I don't know about you, but you can watch the news and see that we're in a critical time, not necessarily negative, but critical. But then we look at our individual lives. If I went around and we polled every single person present and watching, you always say that this is a critical time, whether we're looking to go to college, get out of college, retire, get a promotion, have a baby, raise a child, whatever it is, get married, whatever it is, it's a critical time, church. In this critical time, it's important, it's essential that we redeem the time, which is the theme for our worldwide ministry. We're in Ephesians chapter 5, right? Let's start reading in verse number 1. This is Apostle Paul writing to the church of Ephesus. Ephesians 5, starting in verse number 1. Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children, and walk in love, as Christ also has loved us and have given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. Go down to verse number 8. For ye were sometimes darkness, but now ye are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, proving what is the acceptable unto the Lord, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. For it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret. But all things that are reproved are made manifest by the light. For whatsoever doth make manifest is light. Wherefore he saith, awake, thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Church, here's what Bishop Cherry stated back on the first day of the year, of this year. He said that to fulfill the plan of God, we must redeem the time. Then he gave us a list of definitions of what redeem the time means. He said, church, to redeem the time, we must make this time good. Church, we have to make the time that we have remaining good. When we say good, have a beneficial effect in our lives. When we say redeem the time, fulfill the time. Accomplish a designated work in the designated time. You know, there's a period of time that the world even gives us to get work done. For those of us who are in high school, you can't be in high school all your life. See, we find it odd when we hear that somebody who's in their 30s is still in high school. We're not judging them. It's just that we've all determined that up to about 18 is when you should be in high school. We always celebrate somebody who gets their college degree in their 80s, but we think, wow, that's awfully late. They could have got it when they were in their 20s, but for different reasons they didn't. But we have to accomplish a designated work in the designated time. Church, redeeming the time also means to reclaim the time. It also means to rescue time from evil. That's my favorite definition of it. We have to rescue time from evil. It also means that we have to change how we use time for the better. You know, you can use time to your advantage, or time will use you to your disadvantage. It also means that we have to save time from being wasted. We have to save time from being wasted. And church, it also means to use time to compensate for poor performance. To use time to compensate for poor performance. And there are five things that Bishop Cherry offered about time that I want to go back over very quickly. Church, he said, God gave us time. And God would have not given it to us if it were not important. Whatever God gives us, it's important because it came from God. He also said that time is a limited resource. Listen to this statement, church. Time is valuable, but it's uncertain. Time is valuable, but it's uncertain. So my wife did the whole 1, 2, 3 welcome earlier, right? So at the count of three, I want everybody to shout out their birthday, the month and the day and the month, not the year. I had to think back that far. So at the count of three, the day and the month, right? Just shout out as loud as you can. You ready? 1, 2, 3. Very good. Now, on the count of three, shout out your death day. 1, 2, 3. Wait a minute. We know our birthday. Mine is June 28th, by the way. 17 neck, 36, 37 sleeve, 32 inseam. Don't worry about the waist right now. I want to give you that right now. 38. But it's interesting. We know our birthday. June 28th, 1966. Boom. I can give you that date easily. But none of us can give us our death date. Why not? Because we don't know. So since we don't know our death date, why are we wasting time? My uncle just passed yesterday. Now, the nurse, God bless, we had a good time with that one nurse. She was hilarious. We love her. I asked her a question that we all ask when loved ones get to that point. I said, well, ma'am, how long does he have? And I tried my best to try to fix it up as best I could. And she said, based upon my clinical presentation, I was like, woof. I said, well, sister, come on. She said, it would be good if he even made it through the day on Thursday. So we went to lunch. We came back. And he was still, you know, doing his thing. And she didn't even know. He made up in his mind to pass yesterday. But we don't know. So what if one of us, either here or watching, today's your last day, and you don't know it. But you waste your whole day in unforgiveness, righteous living, focus on things that ought not matter. You're dwelling on the past. You're dwelling on the past, and today is your last day on earth. And you're focused on what happened 50 years ago, and you don't have 50 minutes left. Time's uncertain. And I don't know about you, but when I reach 50, I realize that the likelihood of me doubling my age, my uncle lived to 87, so my father lived to 85, 84, I think was the number. Okay, so there might be a shot to get into the 80s, if we just let, looking at, those two men in my life. But I'm on this tear right now as though today is my last day. How I operate, how I do everything in my life, even how I rest, even how I watch my TV shows. I plan everything I do because I don't want to have died, gone to heaven, and God said, man, Mike, you could have done more in the time you had remaining. Amen. You could have done so much more. So I'm not going to waste my time, and I'm not going to let anybody else waste my time. Get rid of the time robbers. Once you deal with those unproductive thoughts, get rid of the time robbers in your life, even if they have your last name. Y'all can go ahead and be miserable and taking, antacid medicine and all that. People in our families go crazy, right? They just go, let them go crazy by themselves. Because see, this might be my eulogy for my uncle, because it's helping me. Because now some folk won't come off the woodwork. Because there's a house down south. We got to deal with that. So and there's already some rumbling out there. So God said, fix your heart now. Because the time robbers are coming. Because when someone dies, he promised me the car. He promised me the TV. He promised me the... I don't even know your first name. He promised you all that? Really? Okay. Anyway. Church, time is a unit of measurement. Time measures a movement and progress. How far, how much, how long. It measures activity and inactivity. The reason why we hate traffic so much, time is moving and we're not. And boy, I like that trip down to North Carolina now. It's 70 miles per hour. That's the stated speed limit. The stated speed limit. Which by law, you can go up. Thank you. I ain't gonna say it. Because I hit that 10. Oh, we were rolling down North Carolina, boy. And those cops were everywhere, like flies, but they didn't catch me. Oh, I'm sorry. I was alert to their positions. Thank you for Waze. There's that police officer, and 0.5 miles ahead of you, slow down. Babe, the speed limit said 70. But church, that's why we hate traffic so much. See, even those of us who waste time, we hate wasting time. We just don't know that we're wasting our own time. We hate it. How about this? We hate it when our time is being wasted. We just don't realize that we're the ones wasting time. Yeah. None of this is in my notes, by the way, which is hilarious. Thank you. Thank you, Mother. See, time tells the truth about whether we've done what we were supposed to do or not. Time will tell. Time will tell on us. Time doesn't consider feelings, emotions, doesn't care about, how you started in life, whether your mama knew your daddy, whether they were married or not. Time doesn't care about any of that. Time tells the truth. Time does not lie. doesn't it all? Time sets expectations. It says here, time allows us to look at the past, see the present, and determine where we ought to be in the future. Time sets expectations, church. And listen to this last statement that Bishop gave. He said, time has an end. Every season has an end. Now, for those who don't know, I develop all my messages or the outline for the whole year between October and December of every year. Listen to his intent from what Bishop taught on the first day of this year. The intent of the message he gave was to walk. Guess what the title of the message is today? Walk! Exclamation point. Walk. And listen to this key statement that he actually gave. And I'm going to paraphrase it. If we're walking, we're living. If we're walking, we're living. Conversely, if we're stagnant, we're dead. If we're walking, we're living. If we're not moving, we're dead, church. Listen to, and this is newer information that you may not have. You should have it, but you may not have it, and that's okay. Listen to these definitions of walk. First definition, to go. Simply means to go. Second definition of walk, to make your or our way. To make your way. To make our way. Walk also means to make progress daily. Right. To make progress daily. This is my favorite one. Walk also means to take advantage of the opportunity. To walk, to take advantage of the opportunity. Walk also means to live. I said earlier, if you're walking, you're living. It means to live. In the simplest definition of walk, to take steps. The first thing a child learns to do, one of the first things a child learns to do, is to walk. So I'll go over those definitions to make sure you have them. To go, to make your way daily, to make progress daily, to take advantage of the opportunity, to live, and to take steps. Listen to the intent of this message for walk. To move with fear. We spent 15 weeks on moving with fear. Guess what? Our intent is to move with fear and not with fright. Right. We have to move with fear and not with fright. See, here's the issue that I've identified with us as Christians. See, we have to obey God for who He is. And that came up in your prayer today. Thank you very much. I always listen to your prayers. We must obey God for who He is and not what we think He's going to do to us if we don't obey Him. That's fright. See, moving with fear is to obey Him for who He is. To move with fright is to be worried about the consequences of not doing what He said. And I think a lot of us move with fright as it relates to God. We're more worried about what He's going to do to us or not do to us because we didn't do what we were supposed to do. Instead of just obeying Him because of who He is. You know what? You can tell when you become a mature child. When you obey your parents for who they are and not what they're going to do or not do for you. See, when I was only a child and my mother would say, have the dishes washed before I get home. And I'm sitting there watching TV and it's 3 o'clock, and it's 4 o'clock, then it's 5 o'clock, and I see her car pull up into the driveway, guess what? I move with fright. Because I don't feel like hearing her mouth. You've been home all day. All I asked you to do was wash them dishes, and you didn't have the decency of doing that. Instead of when she would say, do the dishes with my father. See, if trash day for us was on Friday. So my father would say, you know that on Friday, trash day is here. So Thursday night, you gather up all the trash. Then you take out the cans to the curb on Friday morning. So if I have respect for them and want to honor them by moving with fear, I'm going to wash the dishes earlier. Matter of fact, I might do it right when she says it. Have it be done. And then when it's time for the trash, I don't have to wait for my father to remind me that it's Thursday, because I know that my favorite TV show back then made it came on Thursday. So if I can remember that, as my father would say, then you can remember to take the trash out. So instead of moving with fright with the Lord, move with fear, with reverence and respect for who he is, not for what he can do or not do, and you suffer the consequences of you not doing what he asked you to do. Here's the purpose. And you said this in your prayer too. I'm listening. The purpose of this series or this message, to press towards the mark of the high calling of God. To press towards the mark of the high calling of God. Go with me over to Philippians chapter 3. If you're Ephesians, guess what? Right next door is Philippians. Go to Philippians chapter 3. And again, this is Apostle Paul. Now he's writing to the church of Philippi, which is the church that we're patterned after. I'm going to start reading at verse number 1 of Philippians chapter 3. And I may embellish this a little bit, so bear with me. Finally, my brethren and my sisterin, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you, to me indeed, is not grievous, but for you it is safe. For me to do a review of the last 15 weeks, it's not grievous for me, and it's safe for you. Sisters, beware of dogs. I'm sorry, I know I didn't say that. It says, beware of dogs, beware of evil workers, and beware of the concision, those who try to divide us. Look at verse 3. For we are the circumcision, which worship God in spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus, and have no confidence in the flesh. And then what you see there next is Apostle Paul begins to describe all his great pedigree. Go down to verse 7. Having said all the things about his pedigree, he says, but what things were gained to me, those I counted lost for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might obtain unto the resurrection of the dead, not as though I had already obtained, neither were already perfect, but I follow after. How about that? I follow after, I walk after, if that I may apprehend, that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this thing I do, this one thing I do. How about this? Forgetting those things which are behind, forgetting the past, and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Go down to verse 17. Brethren and sisters, how about this? Be followers together of me. Walk together and follow me. And mark them which walk so as ye have us for an example. For many walk of whom have told you often, I have told you often, and now tell you, even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. Church, we have to mark those who walk with us and make sure that everyone you're walking with is walking first in the same direction and walking the same way and following the same Lord. But I want to go back to verse 14. He says, I press towards the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. In other words, I'm a press so hard, I'm a walk towards Jesus. And I want all those who are following me as I follow Jesus to follow after me. Church, the goal of this message today is to conform to the image of Jesus Christ. I want us to walk after Jesus so much that we end up looking just like, speaking like, and acting just like him. I want us to walk so much with Jesus that people can't tell the difference between us and Jesus. Listen to the objectives or the message titles for the rest of the year. I gave them to you on the 8th of January. I'm going to give them to you again. Church, we have to walk in love. We have to walk after the Spirit. We have to walk worthy. We have to walk in the light. We have to walk circumspectly. The Word of God says walk circumspectly, not as fools. We also have to walk so that others can follow us. Here's the one that I added after our resurrection, or I should say our Holy Week services. We have to walk like the disciples. I can't wait to get there. And our last message of the year on Sunday will be, we have to walk until. I'll repeat that. We have to walk in love, walk after the Spirit, walk worthy, walk in the light, walk circumspectly, walk so that others can follow us, walk like the disciples, and walk until. Church, in order to walk on the path of righteousness, guess what you have to do? Give your life to Jesus Christ. Because the path you're walking on right now leads to hell. I'm not going to clean it up. I'm not going to make it sound better than that. I wish somebody would have told me the truth back when I was out there in them streets. If you want to walk on the path of righteousness, in other words, walk with God, be in right standing with God, be positionally right with him, you have to give your life to Jesus Christ. And if you're present, whether you're present here in the sanctuary, present watching the live broadcast, present watching the rebroadcast, if you know for a fact that you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, I want you to signal me by raising your hand. Don't be cute. This ain't the time to play. Because remember now, we don't know how much time we have left. So one of the ways you can redeem the time, the best way that you can redeem the time, is to give your life to Jesus Christ. Whether you're here, whether you're watching, or whether you're watching by the live broadcast, even for those watching by the live broadcast, we're going to pray a simple prayer with you to make sure that everyone's in the body of Christ. And if by chance there's someone present and you didn't feel quite comfortable standing up and raising your hand or what have you, let us know after service so that we can welcome you into the body of Christ. Amen? Pray this prayer with me. Dear Heavenly Father, I confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus, and I believe in my heart that you, Father, raised Jesus from the dead. Today I'm saved, I'm changed to be unchangeable. Thank you, Father, I praise you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, welcome to the body of Christ. And what I want you to do, for those who might have prayed that prayer here, let us know after service and we can acknowledge you then. But also for those folks watching by the live stream or the rebroadcast, I want you to go ahead and click on our home screen on the I'm New button. And when you do so, click on the plan of salvation, read that entire plan, because guess what? You're in the plan. Go back up to the top, click on the button where it says I accepted Jesus Christ. And when you do so, hit submit or follow the prompts and then hit submit. And then someone from this great office will reach out to you and welcome you to the new body of Christ, or the body of Christ, I should say. And then if by chance you want to join this great Bible-believing, Bible-teaching church where Jesus Christ is Lord, exclamation point, all you have to do, again, for those present who want to join, let us know after service and we'll take you in immediately after service. Those who are watching by the live stream or the rebroadcast, just minimize the screen, click on the I'm New tab, click on How Do I Join the Church button, follow the prompts that are there, hit submit, and then someone from our restoration ministry will reach out to you and welcome you to your new church home. Amen?
Amen.
Well, family, I love you and I appreciate you and I thank you again for your love and your attention and just the support you're offering to me and my family at this time. But it's now time for us to go home. Amen?
Amen.
Let us stand to receive our benediction. Let us pray. Father, I thank you so much for what our eyes have seen, what our ears have heard, but most especially what our heart has received. And we thank you, Father, that you guided us here by your Spirit. And it's by your Spirit that we're going to leave this place. We're not going to leave this place doing our own will, but we're going to listen attentively to you to do your will. We love you, Father. We praise you, Father. It's in Jesus Christ's name we do pray and give thanks. Amen. Love you all. We'll see you all this Wednesday. Be blessed.